So, if you've been around certain corners of the internet, then you're definitely familiar with lost media. I, like so many others, find the concept intriguing. You know, there is a dark sort of wonder around TV shows, movies, and books that we no longer have access to. And while it's amazing to see big communities come together and discuss, look for, and analyze lost media, more often than not, the trail leads to a dead end. That's why I think a smaller, more nebulous cross-section of media deserves a lot more attention online. Stuff that is documented and somewhat available, but maybe too rare or obscure to really be accessible. Forgotten media, perhaps? Since high school, I've made a steady hobby of venturing to thrift stores and flea markets specifically to look for the strangest, most mysterious thing I can find buried amongst the coffee table books and inordinate amounts of Family Guy DVDs that every Goodwill seems to have for some reason. And in my searches, something always seems to call out from the shelves. Some artifact of a vibrant subculture that has long since faded from popular memory. We can often be so spoiled by the massive amounts of entertainment available right at our fingertips that we neglect the smaller, more fringe stories slowly receding in the rearview mirrors of time. Stories that may not be super relevant or polished, but in their own humble obscurity, really have something to say, in my opinion. And I think it's about time that I actually share some of the ones I found with you. So, there's this antique bookstore by my university that has an entire section dedicated to secondhand music. This part of the store goes deep. Like, really deep. It's like a dungeon. Combing through the absurd number of vinyl records and CDs, I came across an album cover that really seemed to tickle my fancy. Whether it was the Greek punk hardcore label, the poor English title, or the badass skull on the front, I knew I had to buy it. This is Uncontrolled Decease, a split LP between three different bands. Ningjida, Porphyria, and Corruption. Split LPs are actually very common in the hardcore punk world. I can think of a couple off the top of my head. Basically, it's a bunch of different songs by a bunch of different bands on one record. On the back, we have a track list that is in both English and Greek. I can read a little bit of the Greek alphabet, but that doesn't mean I know what any of it says. I recognize the name Stamatis here on the bottom, which is a common Greek name, and that's it. So, like a 20th century archaeologist reconstructing an ancient Greek Linear B tablet, I combined what I knew about the Greek language along with the scholarly resources at my disposal, and typed everything into Google Translate. To the best of my knowledge, here's what it said. All the songs were recorded in Backstage Studio with Giorgos Anagnostou, except the one that was recorded in the Red House Studio with Kostas Stratagopoulos. The cover was made by Stamatis based on designs from the previous century. I'm not sure who Stamatis is, they didn't provide his last name, but I gotta hand it to him. I like his cover art. The skull is half the reason I bought it. Come on, it's a classic hardcore staple. My favorite band Gizm does it all the time. Look, this one's even performing Fallacia. Death? You know they got skeletons. That's a good album cover. This is seriously how I judge music, I should be put in jail. Stamatis designed the front cover, but I know for a fact he didn't do the back. Now, initially, this looked to me like some standard Tolkien-esque dungeon synth circle jerk art. But upon closer inspection, this looks like an illustration from the first scene of Macbeth. Yeah, with the witches and everything. Hey, I actually remembered something from high school English! At the bottom, it's signed by an A. Rackham. So I searched up A. Rackham Macbeth, and aha! An English book illustrator. Nice. Don't really know what Shakespeare has to do with extreme noise hardcore stuff, but I'll take it. I mean, I guess Macbeth's pretty metal, in like a Rodney James Dio kind of way. Now, Ningjida and Corruption, named after an ancient Sumerian god and the current state of democracy respectfully, are more of a black death metal sound, while Porphyria is straight up hardcore punk. So, the record I got actually came with this pamphlet. At last, the ultimate death metal bands, Ningjida and Corruption, and the hardcore band Porphyria, released on vinyl some of their greatest stuff. Get your copy now for money. Order more than 15 cost 5.5 per copy. Orders more than 50 cost 5 per copy. These prices are for Europe. From elsewhere, add 1IRC, send your letters to, I'm not doxing them. Limited edition of 500 copies only. So that's actually really interesting. I guess the guy who owned this before me decided to include this little, what looks like a Xerox of an advertisement. Yeah, this does not sound like it was meant for consumers though. This sounds like it was meant to go out to like record stores and stuff.
Kind of unfortunate that I never really did get to see them in record stores, but I don't live in Greece. If any of you live in Greece, let me know if you've heard of these guys before. But yeah, 500 copies only. Wow. No wonder I can't find anything about this on the internet. Oh yeah, about that.
Online, specific information about these bands is scarce. Porfiria seems to be the most recognized, having appeared on other split LPs and even some self-released albums on cassette. This art looks interesting. Hey look, there's Stamatis again. Porfiria is also the only band here to have a photograph on Discogs, maybe. It's hard to confirm who this photo actually shows, especially since the profile for Ningishida has a picture of a different German band called Ningishida that's spelled differently. Also, finding anything on Corruption is next to impossible because, they called their band Corruption. Seriously, Discog lists over 20 other bands including or having the word Corruption in their name. I'm sorry, but you're not really standing out in metal with a name like that. Not that it helped Ningishida.
Now, in terms of music on this record, I like it. 14-year-old Chris would have been overjoyed to crank this on the stereo, but as I am now, it's alright. I've definitely heard worse hardcore and death metal before, and for a split LP, it's actually pretty solid. I especially love the percussive punchiness of all of Porfiria's tracks. And Corruption has this great chugging riff that always gets stuck in my head. It's pretty generic in terms of metal and sounds vaguely Metallica, but I dig it. Ningishida, on the other hand, has this very unique style that sort of mixes blast beats and shrill riffs. It sounds very black metal or second wave black metal inspired, which is crazy because this came out in 1989 before all of that stuff. Something is a little off about Ningishida's drumming. It doesn't sound like they keep time very well. But who am I to judge? I'm not a drum person.
It's very clearly not for everyone, and even to my hardcore loving ears, the production sounds cheap. However, there is a sort of a charm to that. It reminds me of the thrashy noise I would make with my friends in the basement jam sessions of yesteryear. Guitars and drums just blasting away the anguished sound of our frustrated youth. It never sounded professional or clean or good, but it was raw and powerful to us, and we enjoyed making it. And I think that's all that matters.
I'm glad I got this record. I feel like I own a piece of Greek underground music history, you know? And it is a good physical reminder that death metal and hardcore and all of that is kind of like a tradition. It stayed the same but changed so much. The sheer noise terror that angry Greek kids made in the 80s still echoes off of venue halls and garage walls the world over. If you want to let Uncontrolled Decease echo all over your walls today, I left a link to an archive in the description. And if Porfiria, Ningishida, and Corruption are all still out there today, efcharisto. You guys make a good hardcore record.
On to the next one.
Now Google Docs can finally stop autocorrecting me. It's Decease, goddammit. Decease. You're letting Ningishida get away with this shit, Google? Come on.
Even if you can't read what it says or have no idea what's going on, look at that. How can you not be on board with whatever the heck this is?
So, I found this old manga at a local Goodwill, believe it or not. This is Kodai Sanchi no Kyoryu-kun, a collection of short stories by Shinzawa Motoe. While not really a household name overseas, Shinzawa Motoe is a popular manga artist in his native Japan. The prime of his fame came in the early 80s with his weekly Shonen Jump series, High School Kimengumi, a will-they-won't-they style comedy between a girl named Kawayui and a group of weird-looking boys called the Kimengumi, which means something along the lines of Funny Face Club. Yeah, it would appear that outside the context of Japanese culture, Shinzawa's particular brand of humor has a hard time translating, which is probably why he never really quite reached the American market. Surprisingly though, his Kimengumi series was very popular in France, published under the name Le Collage Fou Fou Fou. In fact, Shinzawa's work was so popular with French audiences that Kodai-san, the book we're talking about today, was marketed as a spin-off to Le Collage Fou Fou Fou, despite them being completely separate works. As far as the English manga translations or anime dubs of Shinzawa's work go, here's what I found.
Greek語と違って少し日本語を話せます。でもまだ勉強します。
個人的に日本語を読むことは日本語を話すより簡単だと思います。
That is a note though, take all of my translations with a grain of salt. The title, Kodai-san-chi no Kyoryu-kun, translates to the best of my knowledge as Mr. Kodai's Dinosaur, or Kodai-san's Dinosaur-kun. But you don't need to be freaking James Curtis Hepburn to figure out that one of these words says dinosaur.
I would feel lied to if it didn't.
Kodai basically means ancient times, but grammatically here it's used like a name, so that's what I'm going with. Shinzawa Motoe seems to name a lot of his characters after puns. I know there's a bunch of them in High School Kimengumi, Kawaiyui, Retsugo, Daimajin. Again, another aspect of his comedy that would be very hard to explain to non-Japanese audiences.
So Kodai's dinosaur appears to be about a dad bringing home a pet dinosaur for his kids, but that's just one of the stories. There's 10 in this collection. Flipping through the pages, I can already see why drawing funny faces was Shinzawa Motoe's thing. This guy is an incredibly vivid artist. All of his characters are so emotive and unique in their design. You can tell he takes particular care when drafting characters' faces, how they look at rest and how they look when they emote. I especially admire how he's not afraid to let his expressions go a little off-mile, stretching the face to absurd proportions. And forget what I said earlier about the humor not translating well. Some of these stories are so internally absurd and quick with their payoffs that they actually read like memes. For example, Kaiketsu Gokunman is literally about a superhero who gets his power from drinking alcohol. And he doesn't even really help people, he just kinda screws up everything he tries with the same dopey expression on his face. Funny because Shinzawa just reused Go's face from Kimen Gumi for Gokunman. There's also another series called Oya Oya Oyaji, which is a pun on the Japanese word for father. Kind of like saying the oh my god dads, but the basic sentiment is the holy shit dads. It's a mini series about a bunch of dads who each have a quirk in some way that makes them a bad parent. There's a drunk one, a stubborn one, a perverted one. Whoa, yeah, we're not touching this one.
I don't think anything good can come out of that face.
In one of these stories, a rich father catches his son smoking outside. He slaps the absolute shit out of him and admonishes the boy for smoking cheap cigarettes before offering him expensive ones.
No son of mine will smoke mids.
Some of the humor wouldn't work without Shinzawa's artistic abilities. The jarring contrast between the standard cutesy manga characters and the nearly anatomically correct velociraptor in Kodai-san's dinosaur is literally the whole joke. Watching it beef with all the Kodai family kids and eventually befriending the youngest boy to fight off some neighborhood bullies is a story so vividly detailed and succinct, you don't need language to understand it. And there's a surprising amount of heart, too, especially between the boy and the dinosaur. Just look at that scaly little dude. That's what I've come to love about Shinzawa Motoe's work. It lures you in with absurd physical slapstick comedy, but then settles with grace on a touching and sometimes melancholy note. And I think none of his stories embody that more than the first one in this collection, Partner Shinji-kun. Patana Shinji-kun is about a boyish young girl named Taiko. Ever since she was little, she was always owning boys in outdoor games and getting into trouble. A gaki daisho, she calls it. However, there was always one boy who stayed constant in her life. A shut-in with a huge birthmark on his forehead named Shinji. Always by her side, she shared in his fascination with the natural world. Looking through the telescope at the stars and doing whatever that is. Cut to modern day and their relationship has completely changed. Taiko's parents let Shinji into the house to wake her up on the first day of school and she gets freaked out and immediately slaps him. It's explained that Shinji's parents live and work far away and that he fends for himself at home without them, occasionally dropping by Taiko's house to have breakfast and walk her to school. Taiko could not be more annoyed by this. Even though he's respectful to his parents and all around just a shy, nice guy, for some reason she's really nasty to him. Even saying some pretty vulgar things that I'm not translating. Even her parents are like, dude, chill. Anyways, Shinji just kind of smiles through it awkwardly, which pisses Taiko off so much that she literally chases him all the way to school. In class, Taiko and the other girls are ogling some cute transfer student when we finally see what makes Shinji so insufferable to her.
Yokatara, boku no daisuki UFO sashinshu issho ni kanchou shinai ka?
And that's when you realize, being around Shinji and his weird behavior is like social suicide for Taiko. Every time he embarrasses himself publicly or says something weird, their peers make fun of her too, simply by association. Her friends even ditch them both when they see Shinji literally trying to move a cicada with his mind powers. Yeah, this behavior is a reference to a Japanese social phenomenon called Chunibyo, where many socially ostracized kids explain their loneliness away with delusions of magic powers or contact with UFOs. Just look it up, I don't have time. This is when Taiko meets her breaking point. She runs away from Shinji and bitches to her parents about him. Her parents are again like, dude, chill. Her frustrations boil over so much that she eventually shouts,
あのやつ両親と一緒に転校しちゃえばよかったのに!
Having no idea that Shinji is standing right there. Defeated, Shinji walks away, with Taiko coldly ignoring him. That night, Taiko reflects on her choice of words. While she meant every word she said, she realizes now that she could have been more delicate.
You think?
Looking through an old photo album, a striking realization hits her. Shinji didn't always have that weird birthmark on his forehead. Strange, she always remembers him having it. Her mom comes in to jump scare her, apparently, and explain what's going on. One day when they were little, Taiko was climbing a dangerously tall tree when she slipped and fell. Thrusted into a quick time event, Shinji scrambled to catch her, but he didn't have his timing right, it seems. She crashes into him, slamming Shinji's head against the ground, pressing the ridges of a stray bottle cap on his forehead. Oh my god, that's a lot of blood. While Shinji came out with a permanent scar on his head, he saved Taiko's life. She's still here today because of him. With her mother reminding her of her past, Taiko is moved to tears. It turns out this whole time, he was also taking the blows for her mistakes. He was always there for her to fall back on. Sometimes literally. Ready to reconcile, Taiko peeks out the window at Shinji's house, only to catch him gazing longingly at the night sky. Alone. Wishing that some UFO out there maybe hears him. His obsession with aliens, his absent parents, his need to stand out and be special. Maybe all this kid ever really wanted was companionship. Not everyone knows how to socialize properly and with grace. Everyone is dealing with something, and it can get in the way of connecting with other people. Sometimes those in our lives who are hardest to love are the ones who need it the most. The story ends on this panel, with Taiko walking Shinji to school this time as he gets sidetracked by an ammonite fossil in the wall. Her final narration says,
翌日からはほんの少し Shinji 君を見直した私ですが、果たして数日まで続くが人心のほどは定かではありません。
Oh, what a cute little story. I honestly like how quickly it ends. It gives the suggestion that their friendship only got stronger as they aged together. Definitely the second best manga about a depressed guy named Shinji.
I know I can't possibly do this story justice with my limited knowledge of Japanese. And unlike the back of a Greek hardcore record, this isn't really something I want to just plug into Google Translate to get the information out. I feel like that would dampen the impact the rest of these stories could have for me. As I get better at Japanese, I hope to come back to this book and slowly piece together its message, its humor, and my overall understanding of it. I would love to recommend you guys this book, but seeing as there's no English copies I can find and all the Japanese ones are behind a paywall... Maybe I'll talk more about this book and Shinzawa Motoe in the future. Who knows?
Shinzawa-san, 素晴らしく面白い漫画を書いてくれて本当にありがとうございました。
Alright, so for this final section, I want to take a look at this foreign DVD I found at another Goodwill. When I first saw it, though, I recognized the language on the front as Georgian. However, unlike simple Greek phonetics and a little bit of conversational Japanese, I don't know any Georgian. I've been interested in the culture, the history, and the music of Georgia for a very long time, but I pretty much only know how to say Gomajorba, which means hello, and... Yeah, none of this says that. Thankfully, though, there's English translations next to every word, and a lot of it's on the back as well, so that saves me a lot of trouble.
Flipping to the back cover, there's a short blurb about the talent behind this video. Zaza Kolelishvili was born in Telavi, Georgia, then part of the Soviet Union. With a storied career, Zaza was fortunate enough to enter into the Soviet film industry at a time when the government was allowing filmmakers to experiment with newer, previously relegated forms of cinema. Many republics and ethnic groups within the Soviet Union were using this new creative freedom to express themselves and showcase their local culture on the big screen. Notably among the films produced was The Wishing Tree, a Georgian language film released in 1976 featuring Zaza himself. This film shot Zaza into stardom, leading him to become one of Georgia's most beloved actors. Like many actors before him, to varying degrees of success, Zaza Kolelishvili would eventually try his hand behind the camera. Garigiba, or The Deal in English, was his directorial debut released in 1993. English information on this film is hard to come by, and I can't seem to find any version of it with subtitles other than Georgian.
However, the DVD copy I have actually has Garigiba, aka The Deal, on it. Or... Dial There's English translations on the cover, which would hopefully suggest that there's English subtitles too. Spoiler alert, there aren't any. At least not for Dial. Deal. Curiously, there's an option on the DVD labeled Stelka, which is deal in Russian. And yeah, it appears to be a Russian dub of the film.
Mito!
Mito!
Dai, хуй забить,
просыпайся, опаздываю.
Mito! Dai, хуй забить, магуям тебя.
But what do we have here? Aha! English subtitles. Now, those subs are unfortunately not for Dial. Those subtitles, in fact, are not for Gerigaba, but the other two films on this disc, which I'm a lot more interested in. That is an interesting development, though. It seems that this DVD was a sort of effort to export Zaza's films to an international audience.
Grandpa from Kutaisi and The Two Hevshors were both released in 2005 and 2006, respectively. On the cover, however, The Two Hevshors is called The Two Mountaineers instead. And on the back, it's two from Hevshoreti. However, the film says Hevshors or Kevshors, which appears to be the Georgian demonym, so that's the title I'm going with. This film is about two men crossing paths in the snowy mountains of Hevshoreti. One young and open-minded, the other old and traditional. Their comedic encounter and subsequent debate is shot like a mock silent movie, although there is some interesting play with suggesting some diegetic sound, especially the music and folk song lyric. Overall, it's a very interesting watch, especially as a foreigner to Kartvelian culture. Grandpa from Kutaisi is a much more grounded, heartwarming comedy about a man who must send his wife and daughter away to Greece to help out with their dire financial situation. Speaking of dire financial situations, you've probably noticed by now that the production value on these films isn't the highest. I mean, this scene where the mother and daughter arrive in Greece was clearly shot during a vacation in Athens with a camcorder. I wonder what that shop's selling. I bet it's copies of Uncontrolled Decease. That's not to say these movies are bad or low quality. In fact, a lot of the edits and shot compositions demonstrate a clear understanding of visual storytelling. Zaza Kolelishvili was working in the industry for a very long time before he directed these, after all. Watching these films and researching Kolelishvili has convinced me that I need to dedicate a whole video to analyzing his filmmaking skills. Seriously, a lot of the films this man has helped create are on par with Stan Brakhage. And I feel like I need to fully cover these films and give them a proper analysis because
these films are lost media. Potentially.
Yeah, I can't find a single copy elsewhere. Not on YouTube, internet archives, or even Facebook, where a surprising amount of Georgian films are circulated. They're not even listed on Zaza Kolelishvili's IMDb page. There is but the mere suggestion that they exist online, only being mentioned on the Georgian version of Wikipedia's page on Kolelishvili's filmography. And even then, there's no article or external links attached.
So you understand why I owe it to this DVD and Zaza Kolelishvili's legacy to bring these movies to the surface so we can all enjoy them. I think that's all I really wanted to say about this. That looks to be like the last of the stuff I wanted to talk about. Ah, my knee! Hey, sorry for interrupting you there, Past Chris, but I had to cut in here for a second. Also, if you're gonna mimic a VHS aesthetic, you might as well use the real thing. I still have one item left to talk about, but unfortunately, the backstory behind it is a little unfinished. This is a copy of Dragon Force Operation that I got at a flea market. I was originally going to use it to talk about Hong Kong cinema, the 70s kung fu explosion, and video store rental culture as a whole. However, there's a major problem with my copy. During the intro credits of the film, this happens.
And let me go. So when I was staying at Grandma and Grandpa's, I told them I was going to my friend's house. But instead, I went to the prom. It wasn't like I thought it would be. Derek knew all along that I wasn't old enough. But he kept leading me on, just so he could make an idiot out of me in front of everyone.
Well, daughter, looks as though you exercised some pretty poor judgment. But you were right on two counts. One, you are too young, and two, I wouldn't let you go to the prom.
Where are you going?
We don't have a talk with that boy over there.
Please don't. Frankie already took care of him for me.
What do you mean, Frankie already took care of him?
Well, when Frankie found out what Derek was doing, he punched him.
And just as suddenly as it started, it stops. It appears someone recorded a live TV broadcast over part of the film. And it cuts out at such a pivotal moment that it almost seems purposeful, right after she says,
"He punched him."
So maybe I'm just unfamiliar with a really popular show, but I don't know what this is from. The style and framing lead me to believe that it's a 90s sitcom, but not only is the tone impossible to place, but there's nothing really comedic about it. It's actually kind of dark. If any of you know what this is from, please, please, please let me know in the comment section. I will not rest easy until I find out what this is from. Watch it be some super popular show that I just never seen and everyone's like, Chris, you fucking idiot. Alright folks, that appears to be my time. I now return you to your regularly scheduled Chris from the past.
What the? God damn it, future Chris, you rewinded too far. I didn't even make the video yet.
What the heck just happened? Anyways, if you don't want to miss out on my next video, which will more than likely be about Georgian film, hit the subscribe button and that beautiful little bell under- Hit subscribe and that moderately attractive notification bell so that you can be the first to watch me review Grandpa from Kutaisi,
your new favorite movie.
That being said, thank you all so much for watching, and I hope to see you next time.